In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I just want to be taking the teaching segment by segment so that you will understand where I'm going to. Our head point for today is the power of manifestation. You don't need anointing for transformation. You need anointing for what? For manifestation. But there is one thing about anointing. That is where my focus today is going to be, in the area of transformation. So that when apostle will begin to come in, it will steer us up into that manifestation. There is one thing about anointing. It's a dimension of God's capacity that you can only receive by price. It's a dimension of God's gift, God's grace, God's enablement, God's oil, God's treasure, that it takes condition to receive it. And that is why we are going to be talking about this dimension of transformation that will qualify you to operate in this dimension. Hear this. It is only gift of salvation that has appeared to woman. Anointing doesn't appear to woman. Titus chapter 2 verses 11. He said the grace that bringeth what? Salvation has appeared to all man. That grace that bringeth anointing doesn't appear to woman. When you now begin to read that Titus order, he said, teaching us to deny ungodliness. He wanted to take you to the realm of anointing. He now said, teaching. Your yieldingness to that teaching is what will qualify you for the anointing. Teaching us to deny what? Ungodliness and worldly lust. If you can master that two dimensions with all honesty, you don't need to pray for anointing. If God can begin to help you to walk on ungodliness and He begin to help you to walk on worldly lust, you've already drawing the attention of power of manifestation into your life. Because in the realm of the spirit, it is not only voice that heaven hear. There are three voices that is louder than this your mouth in the realm of the spirit. Number one, your heart is louder than the voice of your mouth in the realm of the spirit. Are you getting what I'm saying? The voice of your heart is louder than the voice of your mouth in the realm of the spirit. God is closer than your heart. It's closer with your heart than your mouth. Two, your action is another voice that is louder than your mouth in the realm of the spirit. Action speak louder than what? Voice. There are things you are communicating and your action is speaking negative. You are crying for God to use you and your action is not talking it. You won't be useful. Are you following me? So action is another thing that speaks in the realm of the spirit. It is when your heart and your action is in alignment. That's when everyone can recognize your voice. When your heart is far from God, your voice is like a noise in heaven. When your action is contradicting the will of God, your voice is like a noise in heaven. The only voice, only word that you are licensed to speak and heaven will hear when your life is not in alignment is when you cry for repentance. Aside from the cry of repentance, when your life is not in alignment, there is no other voice that you will speak that heaven will hear. He said, let those who ask according to the will. He said, it is when you ask according to the will that we have the assurance that He hears us. So that is why when we are talking about this anointing, there are things that we begin to do, that you will begin to do, that even though you don't pray for anointing will naturally come because your life is speaking when your voice is even silent. Your heart is speaking when your voice is also what? It's also silent. Heaven only recognize your voice when your heart and your life is in alignment with the will of God. And that's why I want to focus on those two dimensions. Because transformation deals with your heart and also deals with your what? Your life. Many of us are crying for this anointing we are talking about, and eternity begins to google your heart and they see a wrong motive for that anointing. So that you come to the presence of God with that wrong motive, I thank God, because you won't go with that wrong motive. Am I communicating now? There are people that are looking for this anointing to prove a point. You want to show. And God said, no. You need it, but you are carrying a wrong motive, and that wrong motive is disqualifying you for this thing you are crying for. So the reason why we come for this teaching is so that to work on that your motive, so that when your motive is right, your life is right. Automatically, when you cry for anointing, it will what? It will come. We are not talking this as a theory, we are speaking from experience. Because it takes experiential knowledge and revelational knowledge to teach. And what you are talking begin to enter into the heart of man. If I'm speaking from head, it will hit your head. But if I'm speaking from the heart, where will it go to? It will enter into your heart. So for me to stand in this capacity to talk, I'm not only talking theoretically, I'm talking experientially and what? And revelationally. So I'm focusing that no, for you to attain this thing at the right time, we need to begin to talk on our lives. Let's focus on that dimension, because I wish it is gifts of the Spirit. With all honesty, God can give you without looking at your life or your character. Because do you observe that gift is without repentance, but anointing is with repentance? You understand the reason why God is so very careful about releasing these cost resources into the life of anyone. When a gift enters into your life, even though you fornicate, you can't lose it again. Gift is without repentance. But anointing dries the day you begin to go into sin. So what is now the essence of crying for anointing when you know you will lost it at the lap of Sister Rebecca? What is the essence? If you are following me, shout hallelujah. What is the essence of crying for the anointing you will receive? And you won't know that that anointing, there is a price that followed it. And you leave the presence of God with the anointing demanding consecration. And you go to where they are washing man, you and Chelsea, and you waste the anointing there. Hear this. There is a consecration that follows anointing. And if you don't have the grace to pay the price of that consecration, with all honesty, you will carry the anointing and you will lose it. You will see why many people are looking for impartation about, and we didn't see the manifestation of the impartation. You don't get impartation sheep like that. Anything you get sheep, you will lose it anyhow. I have been imparted. I've never received any impartation physically from any man of God. Because I understand that once I imparted you, don't be happy for the impartation. Ask for the cross that followed the impartation. There is a price of every mantle. If you don't carry the price of the mantle, you will lose the mantle. You will lose it. So the reason why we gather here is to study our life, so that you will even ask yourself, am I qualified for this dimension of the anointing I'm requesting for? Can I host this dimension of the anointing? Am I not a leaking vessel that will receive it and waste it? Am I not a dirty vessel that will not be able to withhold or respond to that anointing? Am I not? So that's why I'm praying that you open the eyes of your understanding, so that the power of transformation will rest upon you. And as you are leaving this place, your life will not remain the same again. So that anything you receive from God, you have the capacity to host it and develop it to manifestation. That's why God is so scared in releasing that dimension of grace. With all honesty, I wish it is gift is enough. Kai, a gifted teacher doesn't need anointing. If you cry for gift as a teacher, God can give it to you.